just wanted to say that this is a very special week in the world of public health. It's actually the 25th anniversary of National Public Health Week. So across the world, this is a week where typically health departments, we may do things like bring in donuts and have an all-staff meeting where we do some fun activities or do some team building to really recognize the public health workers for all the work that they have done. But right now we're in the midst of the most challenging public health crisis that any of us have seen. And in addition, we're also distanced, most of us working from home, intensely busy caring for our communities and working to try to end this pandemic. So our work is typically behind the scenes, and now we're in the public spotlight. So in one sense, it's good that people are now understanding what public health is and what public health does. So just, I wanted to take a moment, this being the 25th anniversary of National Public Health Week, to really put the biggest thank you out there to the over 60 public health staff in the Kenosha County Division of Health and all the amazing, amazing work they're doing. And I invite you to share the same with hashtag Thank You Public Health. That's a worldwide hashtag for recognizing our public health workers on the front lines this week with COVID. So with that, I will just say that getting to the numbers, we are sitting at 127 positives as of late today. The good news is that we have zero positive cases in any of our long-term care facilities or assisted living facilities at this time. And I do believe that that is in part due to some of the early measures we put in with visitor restrictions before we ever even had a positive case in the county, and all the good work that these facilities are doing to really practice distancing and putting in disinfecting measures and personal protective equipment with staff and trying to limit staff from going to facility. So there's lots that they are doing as well in these trying times to try to limit the spread to any long-term care facility. Of our positive numbers, I just wanted to share some updates. Only 55% ever presented with a fever, 70% had a cough, 18% had a sore throat, and we are now down to seeing only 13% are asymptomatic. I think it was a couple weeks ago I reported how we were almost at a quarter of our positives had no symptoms whatsoever, and now we're seeing 13%. We do have a brand new data dashboard out on the website, so hopefully you all have had a chance to see the Kenosha County website has the new COVID resource hub. And if you scroll about a quarter of the way down, you'll see a data dashboard that works both on a computer versus a mobile venue. And this data dashboard is now a way for us to be much more transparent and provide information that I know many people were seeking. So it has the things such as census track. It's not a pinpoint. There's no patient protected information that's being given out on this website. It is all based on census track. All but three of our census tracts have had positive patients. And it does basically show by census tract with a pinpoint right in the middle of that census tract how many cases that census tract has had. So there's no protected health information, again. But it also does break down by gender, by municipality, by age, and by demographics, such as we're seeing in the news how African Americans are disproportionately affected by COVID-19. For Kenosha County, we are only at 7.6% of our positive cases are African American. That's not to say neither here nor there if that's any different. This is all based upon testing. So, as you know, not everybody's able to get a test. Very few tests are out there, or people are not able to get tests. So we can take these numbers that I've just rolled out semi-loosely because it's the best data we have at this time, given the testing that we have had. So please do take a look at that data dashboard on the new website, as we will be keeping that updated. It'll likely get updated every morning, so just once a day. So you may see that there's some slight lag, much similar to the State Health Department's website, which gets updated by 2 p.m. every day. So we try to keep that as updated and accurate as possible. Just some other data points and facts for you. We have received over 300 phone calls through just our health department nurse of the day line. We have received over 84 emails on the brand new COVID-19 at KenoshaCounty.org email. we are responding to 100% of the calls and the emails that we're getting to this time. So we have appropriated certain staff to be able to handle these emails and calls. The general public, when they're having general COVID questions, are calling 211, but these are some more specific or nuanced emails and phone calls that we're getting from the community that we are able to reach back and contact and answer their questions for them. On Facebook, we've had approximately 2,000 comments on our Kenosha County Division of Health Facebook page since March 10th. One post, in fact, though, had over 4,000 shares and reached over 117,000 people. So we are seeing some positive foot traffic on our Facebook page as well. So those are just some more little data points for you about what's happening there. You may have seen this week our press release about wearing cloth masks. This was a new CDC guideline, which I was very happy to see, and we followed suit immediately that we do suggest people where you see many people are sewing these cloth masks, or you can make them relatively easy at home with just a t-shirt and rubber bands. That's all on the CDC website for how to appropriately make one, and it tells you how thick they should be and what kind of material. And we do recommend that people wear those when they have to go out grocery shopping or to pharmacies or places where it's hard to maintain social distancing. So hopefully you have seen that. That was put out this weekend. And then the state just this evening put out some guidance with regard to spiritual gatherings, especially with the upcoming weekend. So more is to come out on that tomorrow as well. But it's basically stating from the state health department that congregating, even in small groups under 10 people, is strongly discouraged. And parking lot services are strongly, strongly discouraged. And so we know that many faiths are rooted in caring for others. And this is where staying home during this safer at home order is one way to practice your faith during this challenging time. We look forward to the day when we can all be together again in person worship and gatherings. And in the meantime, though, please stay connected with one another through virtual means, phone calls, video conferences, the like. I know that that's difficult with this upcoming weekend and all that everybody is experiencing. So more information to come out through the state health department on that in Kenosha County tomorrow. There were also today some new testing guidelines. I have received a few questions about testing that I'll answer now. One is that there was this tier system before, tier 1, 2, 3, and 4. The state has now given new guidelines that are tier A, B, and C. Spiced it up a little bit, I guess. Tier A is essentially what was previously tiers 1 and 2, that only the people that can get tested and through the public health labs, which include the Wisconsin State Lab of Hygiene and the City of Milwaukee Health Department lab, are those who are sick, very sick. Tier 2, though, tier B is for all of those that are the others out there. And the good news about this is that while the Wisconsin State Lab of Hygiene and the City of Milwaukee Health Department lab will not test anybody that's outside of the previous tiers 1 and 2 or this new tier A, it does allow for providers, this is very important, and hospitals to be able to test others as long as they use private labs. So this allows a great deal of autonomy for providers and hospitals to be able to test. We've seen many cases come through where maybe there's a healthcare worker whose spouse is positive, but they're not showing symptoms. Or maybe there's a first responder who came in contact with a positive and they were not previously in the tier 1 and tier 2 to be tested unless they were showing symptoms and were sick. So this does open up the door that if providers or hospitals are using private labs, not the two public health labs, that they can use discretion when testing whoever may need to be tested. We are certainly seeing in the health department that we're having to discuss case-by-case basis what the quarantine and isolation guidelines are, who should get tested, all of that. There are so many nuanced factors to this virus that we're having to basically do a nurse huddle and discuss what needs to happen, what should we do with this case, you know, how long were they in contact with somebody or where did they work, and make these sort of nuanced decisions so that we don't decimate our first responder workforce or our healthcare workforce. And so this is positive news that allows providers and hospitals to be able to also make those case-by-case determinations to be able to test. With that, hopefully we see more testing happening. However, there is, I just want to clarify, hands in the tube that is called a collection kit. And that is, if you go through the drive-through COVID testing site or to your provider, they will put this nasal swab into your nasal passages, and that is really called a collection kit. The test kit is what is on the laboratory end, and that is the reagents and the things they need to use to test your nasal swab in the lab. So there is a bit of a nuanced difference between collection kits and test kits. However, both are in short supply. So we're being told that within the next few weeks, as best as they can, that there will be more test kits and collection kits available much more widely. Is that soon enough? Maybe not, but that is what we're being told, and that is the reason why testing has not ramped up, is that there's just not enough out there and available. I had a question about people seeing new cases on the decline around the state, that maybe numbers are slowing. I caution, though, this is not an indication that the virus is on the decline. This is an indication that testing has gone down. For example, at Freiheit South, they were testing about 70 a day through their drive-through test site, and now they're down to around 30 a day. And again, that's a supplies issue and a laboratory testing issue. So because the number of positives maybe in some places has gone stagnant, it certainly hasn't in Kenosha County, that does not necessarily mean that we're coming over the peak or that we're out of the woods with regard to this coronavirus. So just another little number is that Freiheit South alone has already tested over 1,100, has performed 1,100 tests. And then I had another question: that are all three hospitals in Kenosha seeing COVID patients? So right now, both Aurora and Freiheit South Kenosha, the downtown facility, are the ones that are, and I just want to make sure I'm stating this correctly, are the ones that are housing, if you will, COVID patients. So at the downtown Kenosha Freiheit Hospital, they've been able to isolate both positive and those pending test result patients at that facility. They do have the capacity, if necessary, to isolate COVID positive patients and inpatients with pending test results at the Pleasant Prairie facility if necessary. So when we're looking at sort of the surge capacity issue, we have definitely been seeing that we're not hitting the max hospital resources at this time. They have the ventilators and the room available to be able to handle what is coming next. It brings me to the next question, though. I have received about predictive models. And you may have seen the one coming out from the University of Washington that initially stated Wisconsin would be around April 26th or 27th as far as the resource peak when hospitals in particular might see the most amount of cases. This fluctuates because it's not a perfect science. They're basing it upon when the safer at home order went into place, the number of positive cases we're getting. And again, it's all based on the number of testing, which, as I mentioned before, is not a perfect number to really dictate a predictive model. So the numbers I've seen from the state health department attempted to do another predictive model have been anywhere from April 15 to May 1 as our peak in that area. So a little over a week from now through the end of the month is really where we expect to see the most cases, the most potential deaths, and things that could really peak our resources in the healthcare system over that two-week period of time. So I just want to put that out there, not as a fear tactic, but just to let you know that it's very hard to predict these models. But we are definitely working on the resources that we have available in our healthcare facilities and to be able to ensure that we're able to meet when we hit that peak, whenever that may be. I'm looking through my notes here. I think that covers all the new information that I have to date. And as I finish looking through my notes here, I'm going to check my email to see if I had any other questions from all of you. Sorry for the pause here. questions or anything coming through. So with that, I just want to thank you so much for joining me again. And nothing new here. Okay, that was my question giver. No new questions at this time. So with that, I just want to say thank you all for being de facto public health workers, and I want to celebrate you all in this public health week too, from the media to our first responders to our healthcare workers to all of our county government employees who have proven themselves to be amazing public health workers and partners with us in this. And we cannot thank you enough, because we could not do this alone. So thanks to everyone out there at home for being minding the safer at home order, staying at home as much as possible, not congregating. And we will talk to you hopefully again next week and let you know what is happening